Merry Christmas, everybody. On behalf of all of us here at Memorial, I would like to say welcome to each and every one of you. Those of you that are gathered here in this very space, and those of you that are joining us from your homes or wherever it is that you are gathered this evening, we want you to know that certainly the presence of God is just as much with every one of you as even we are experiencing here in this moment. We're grateful for it, aren't we? There was a lot of this year I wasn't sure that we would make it to Christmas Eve gathered together, and yet we've made it this far. And we'll continue pressing through whatever may come in the days ahead as well. But I am grateful, as always, for an opportunity to worship with each and every one of you, and especially those of you who may be our guests. Maybe you're in town visiting family, or maybe you have come for the very first time, and we want to say a particular welcome to you also. As we prepare our hearts for worship, may we set aside the busyness that sometimes comes along with the season, and may we direct our gaze to God alone in these times. Listen as I read these words. Tonight, old dreams die, and new dreams come to life. The promise is fulfilled. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace. Hope gives way to joy and prayer to proclamation. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace. Our candles illuminate our story. Dawn invades midnight. The light of the world has come. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace. And this light is a light for all, igniting a flame in the soul, warming us from within, radiating love, lighting our lives. With the presence of God, come alive in human flesh, within us and among us, now and always. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace. Let's pray together. God, we are so grateful. Grateful for all that you are and all that you have done, and on a special and holy night like tonight, where we can be reminded of the greatest gift of all. For you have taken on flesh and lived and dwelled among us, that we may have life. So we ask, God, that on this special and holy evening, once more we might lean in and listen. We might continue to fix our gaze upon you, that we might behold both the mystery and the miracle of it all. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them.
Sing with me, if you will. We're going to share some songs together after Joey lights our Christ candle. As he does that, and then we'll sing Angels We Have Heard on High, A Little Town of Bethlehem, and Away in a Manger.
Thank you.
again. Lord Jesus.
A reading from John's Gospel, chapter 1, beginning in verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through Him all things were made. Without Him nothing was made that has been made. In Him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Skipping down to verse 14, the Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. And we have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. One of the things that we get to do on an evening like tonight is to stop whatever it is going on in the midst of our lives and to just behold the miracle. And so I'm going to continually call us back to that place of beholding this evening. And we're going to take a moment now and just have a brief time of silence before the McFarlands begin to play a meditative piece for us here in just a moment. But I want you to consider the miracle of it all.
were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those of us." To your Son, Father, we just thank you for his willingness to come, knowing that he was going to be the ultimate sacrifice for us. So, Father, may we be like the shepherds to hear the angel's response and just celebrate, even tonight, what you have done and the fact that Messiah has come. And because of that, we that believe in him can have the assurance of eternal life. So, Father, we just thank you for your gift of your Son. We pray these things to this.
Let's sing again, beginning with, "O Come All Ye Faithful."
Well, of all evenings to have technical difficulties for those of you at home, Christmas Eve is certainly not ideal. And we're grateful, though, that hopefully now things are up and running with you all, and welcome to join us during these moments. All right. Finishing out the scripture reading from Luke chapter 2 that Mark has been bringing us through thus far. I'm picking up in verse 15. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see the thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. And when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. If you've been with us through these weeks of Advent, you know that one of the things that we have been doing as a church is walking through each particular week with a theme based upon, or at least beginning with, a particular Christmas song that Randy has chosen for us, and he chose a song for each week, and we sort of let that be our jumping off point. And so we've been exploring some pretty common themes of the season, things like hope and peace and joy, but we also spent a week exploring the theme of glory. And one of the almost yearly themes that we approach in one way or another is, of course, the theme of love. And that's one of the places that I want us to focus in on this evening. Because I mentioned earlier the miracle and the mystery of it all. But I think if there was one word that I had to sum up what does all of this mean, is the word love. But before we dive into that a little bit further, I want us to think about the question first. What does this mean? I don't know about you, but every year around this time, I'm always coming right back to that same pretty basic but universal question of humanity. What does this mean? Many of us have at least read an article or perhaps hopefully had a chance to look up and see over the past several days the relatively close alignment of both Jupiter and Saturn. And many people have called that the Christmas star, thinking perhaps maybe this would give us some insight into what it was that set those magi off on their course so long ago, looking for this newborn king. But the truth is, humanity, we've always been stargazers, haven't we? And I, seems like year after year, get stuck with that image of what in the world were those shepherds thinking about out there in the dead of night as they were keeping watch over their flocks? Because the truth is, whether you are a wise man from the east, as you know, Matthew tells the story, he's telling the story of these traveling magi who have come to pay homage to the king, or whether you are just some redneck shepherds out in the backwoods of the Roman Empire, out there with the sheep in the middle of the night, we're all pretty much the same, aren't we? Whether you come from the big city or you come from a gravel road that doesn't even have a name on it, the truth is, at the core of each one of us, we ask those central questions. And that's really what separates the shepherds from the sheep, right? I haven't spent a lot of time around sheep in my life, but I do have a dog and a couple cats now at our house, and I do know that they don't tend to ask the same questions every day that I do. Maybe you've experienced the same sort of thing. There's something about being human that on a very fundamental level, that the things or the events that happen in our lives, or even those bigger questions of purpose and meaning in our lives, those are the questions that stick with us, aren't they? The questions that we carry with us, the questions that haunt us, whether in a good way or perhaps a not so good way, as we make our way through this life. What is the meaning of it all? For as long as humanity's been around, we've been trying to make our way toward God in one way or another, or at least trying to wrap our minds around a little glimpse of God, or try to understand what it is that really brings meaning and purpose to this life, and why were we given it? This vastness of the universe, of the created world around us, how do we make sense of it all? We're all looking for ways to answer those questions. The Christmas story has such an interesting way of both answering many of those questions, but also leaving us with more, right? I mean, of all the ways that God would choose to show up, why this one? Why would the Creator and Sustainer of all choose to make himself so very vulnerable? That picture of vulnerability that, well, when you think about a newborn lying in a dirty stable in the backwoods of the Roman Empire, as I mentioned earlier, well, you don't get much more vulnerable than that, do you? And yet that's the way God chose to come and be with us. And so why is that? Well, again, I think that the key to it all comes back to love. Listen to these words from 1 John chapter 4. You remember that most scholars believe that the Gospel of John was the last gospel written. And so, in other words, John had a little more time to ponder the meaning of it all. And then the letters were written after that. And so as John continued to reflect and to mull over what in the world all of this means, well, maybe this is a fairly good summation. I'm picking up in the middle of a verse 8. It's something you've probably heard before, but it's worth hearing again. God is love. And this is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. And this is how we know that we live in him and he in us. He has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. And if anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God. And so we know and we rely on the love that God has for us. God is love. And whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. It's the key to it all. It's woven into the fabric of creation. It is at the very heart of God's revelation in every way, but particularly in the most important way that we know the heart of God, and that is through Jesus, his Son. For Jesus reveals to us God's very essence. And so, as we think about what those shepherds were processing that day, maybe the beginning of the night, their questions were, you know, much like our questions. How am I going to make it to the end of the week? Or what about that person that I'm interested in forming a special sort of bond with? I wonder if they feel the same way about me. Or how will I continue to provide for my family who needs me to be there for them? Or I wonder what God is up to, whether in my life or in the world around us. Those very questions that all of us carry again. But those questions were taken in a new direction when the sky lit up that night, weren't they? And that's always the case when God shows up in our life. He has a way of reforming our questions and maybe not always answering them in the ways that we assumed, but we continue to press into that journey of learning and discovering and pondering what all of this means. I love what verse 15 in Luke chapter 2 says in this translation. This is the NIV. But it says that when the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened." And thing is a nice and, well, vague term, isn't it? Let's see this thing. If you've ever written that in a paper, your English professor or teacher may have said, choose a better word than that one. But in Greek, it's a little bit more of an interesting term because it seems like, well, the word in Greek is rhema, but it seems like that word is actually referencing the Hebrew word, which is dabar, the Aramaic idea behind. It's not just a thing, but it is a thing that can simultaneously be both a word and a deed. So in other words, it's the sort of thing that speaks in and of itself. And there seems to me to be a bit of power in that collision between word and deed. Because, well, when John chapter 1 talks about Jesus who is the Word, that's a different Greek word for word. Sorry, that's a lot of usage of the same thing I'm giving you there. But when Jesus showed up, it was both an event and a message simultaneously. And so this deed that speaks, it begins to unpack what is the meaning behind the mystery of it all. But yet even in the midst of that, we're still left grappling for understanding this God who's bigger and who loves so much more than we could have ever imagined. Because for generations, as long as history has extended back to the beginning, humans have wondered, what in the world is God like? Or really, most of their questions would be in the plural, what were the gods like? And they thought that most of them were angry or rather indifferent about humanity's situation. But then this little tribe that we know as the Jewish people, or Israel, they were the ones who had the audacity to say, no, God has revealed himself to be just one God, and he's not competing with other gods, and this God isn't a God who is indifferent to what's happening here. But revelation upon revelation, this God has chosen to take on humanity just to be near us. And so when we say Emmanuel, God with us, if that doesn't make us shake in our boots a little bit and need to sit down because we're a little bit woozy, then maybe we've just heard it too much or over-familiarized ourselves with the concept of what does it mean for the Creator of all to come and be near us and live in our neighborhood. But that is the miracle, isn't it? That same word, rhema, I mentioned earlier, both the deed and that which speaks. It shows up twice more in this same passage. And so in verse 17 of Luke chapter 2, it says that when they had seen him, they spread the word. So they, in this point, are talking about it. They're talking about the deed, in other words. And then finally in verse 19, it says that Mary treasured up all these things. Again, a nice vague word. But she's treasuring up all of the mystery and all of the meaning that's intertwined with this miracle that God has done. And I think that every year, Mary in this passage shows up almost as an ideal disciple, one who we are then to emulate as we seek to follow the way of Jesus in our lives. But maybe particularly this year, in 2020, where we found more space, probably at times than what we're comfortable with. Maybe there's been a bit more silence or a bit more alone time than we would normally choose. And maybe you found yourself asking some of those deep-seated questions that all of us carry with us. It seems to me that Mary, the one figure who shows up both at the beginning of Luke's gospel in chapter 1 and 2 and continues throughout the rest of the story, she's sort of that bridge character, isn't she? Because she's there throughout the events of Jesus' life, even through the cross and the empty tomb into the birth of the church in the book of Acts. But you remember what happened after that scene in Luke chapter 2 where Jesus is the young boy and he's teaching in the temple, and remember Mary and Joseph are on their way back home and Jesus gets left behind and lost along the way until they realize it, and then they have to hightail it back to Jerusalem to find him. He's there teaching among the scholars and the scribes. And what does he say? It had to be about my father's business. And then what does the text tell us about what Mary does at that point? It's Luke chapter 2, verse 51, I believe. It says this, his mother treasured all these things in her heart. And so she takes these events, these deeds, these things that happen in the midst of her life. And she continues to carry them with her, wondering, mulling them over, continuing to unpack the mystery and the meaning of the miracles along the way. And so, this year during Christmas time, my prayer for each and every one of us is that we would learn to do the same. Keep considering the miracle. And keep carrying with us the mystery of it all. For God has come. He's with us even now. Can you believe it? Amen. Randy's going to come back up and he's going to play Silent Night, and we are going to sing here in just a moment. Mark's going to come up and light his candle off of the Christ candle, and we're going to begin to pass it around the room, one to another. It's always a special time, isn't it? But sometimes trying to tend to a flame that has been lit is a difficult thing, isn't it? Maybe even as you're holding your candle out and your neighbor is lighting their candle upon yours, it can be a bit perilous at times. But we have to tend to that flame, don't we? So may we this year continue to tend to that flame of light and love and carry those questions of the mystery and the meaning of the miracle each and every step as we continue. Let's sing together. Thank you. I will continue to ponder these things in my heart. I've got a feeling, though, that we're all going to spend the rest of our lives trying to understand what in the world all of this means. But I am convinced of one thing beyond any other, that if Christmas means anything, it means that there is no boundary that God will not cross in his love for you. Thanks be to God. And as you go, may you have a truly Merry Christmas. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his smile upon you and give you peace, now and all of your days. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Spirit. Amen.